Subcommittee will reconvene, and our apologies for the lengthy delay. It is a matter over which we have little control. I am pleased now to welcome our panel of witnesses, and I'll say a brief word of introduction about each. Mr. Brian Roberts is the Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of the Comcast Corporation. Mr. Jeff Zucker is the President and Chief Executive Officer of NBC Universal. Ms. Colleen Abdullah is the President and CEO of WOW, or Wide Open West Internet, Cable and Telephone. Mr. Michael Fiorelli is the Chairman of the NBC TV Affiliates Board. He is also the President and Chief Operating Officer of the Dispatch Printing Company. Dr. Mark Cooper is the Director of Research at the Consumer Federation of America. And Mr. Adam Thayer is the President of the Progress and Freedom Foundation. We welcome each of you this morning. Thank you for your testimony. Without objection, your prepared written statement will be made a part of our record, and we would welcome your oral summary and ask that you keep your oral summary to approximately 5 minutes. Mr. Roberts, we'll be pleased to begin with you. And you need to turn your microphone on and pull it as close as you can so that we can hear you well.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is that okay? It's a privilege to come here today to talk about Comcast's planned joint venture with GE regarding NBC Universal. As has been mentioned, my father, Ralph, is sitting just behind me, started the company almost a half a century ago. And Ralph built the company from a single small cable system in Tupelo, Mississippi, to where we are today. And with this combination, we are taking the next step in our improbable journey. This is indeed an important moment in our history. Let me briefly summarize the transaction. Under our agreement, Comcast will become majority owner of NBC Universal. We'll create a new venture that combines NBCU's broadcast TV, cable programming, movie studio, and theme park businesses with Comcast's limited video programming channels. Comcast will hold 51% of the venture and will manage it, while 49% will remain with GE. The transaction puts two great American communications companies under one roof. It will help to preserve traditional broadcast television, a business that faces serious challenges. And it will also help to accelerate a truly amazing digital future for consumers. Together, Comcast and NBCU can help deliver the anytime, anywhere, multi-platform video experience that Americans want. In combination, we will be a more creative and innovative company that will meet customer demands. And our success will stimulate our competitors to be more innovative, too. So this joint venture should be good for consumers, good for innovation and competition. To leave no doubt about the benefits of the new NBCU, we have made a series of public interest commitments detailing how we will bring viewers more local programming, more children's programming, more diverse programming on more platforms. We've also made commitments to reassure our competitors that we will compete fairly in the marketplace. Let me offer two examples. First, the program access rules have never applied to retransmission consent negotiations, but we volunteer to have the key components of these rules apply to our retransmission negotiations for NBC stations. Second, we want independent programmers with quality content to know that we are determined to help them reach an audience. So we have committed to add at least two new independently owned cable channels to our systems every year beginning in 2011. The combination of NBC and Comcast will have no significant overlap between the assets of the companies. It's primarily vertical, which generally poses fewer antitrust concerns. That also means no massive layoffs, no closures of facilities, nothing to produce hundreds of millions of dollars of, quote, synergies. That is why some on Wall Street may not have initially loved this deal, but this same lack of overlap is why Washington can, because we will grow these great American businesses over the long term and make them more successful, not cut them. Congress has recognized the benefits of vertical integration before and adopted rules in 1992 to address potential risks. At that time, there was almost no competition to cable, and more than half of the channels were owned by cable companies. So Congress created program access and program carriage rules to ensure that a company which owns both cable content and distribution cannot treat competitors unfairly. Those rules have worked in the past and will continue to work. In the last week, some have suggested that our prior legal challenge to certain portions of the program access rules is inconsistent with our commitments in connection with this transaction. But while we have argued and believe that today's marketplace is sufficiently competitive to do away with the program access rules, we didn't pursue this transaction with the intention of not following those rules, and we don't intend to behave any differently. So we are willing to discuss with the FCC making the program access rules binding on us, even if they were to be overturned by the courts. In the past decade, Comcast has come to Washington twice to seek merger approvals, when we acquired cable systems from AT&T and Adelphia. Each time, we explained how consumers would benefit, and in each case, I believe we have delivered. We spent billions of dollars upgrading cable systems to make them state-of-the-art. We created video on demand, which our customers have used 14 billion times. And from a standing start 4 years ago, we now give millions of Americans their first real phone choice. Once again, we have described how consumers will benefit, and I want to assure you that we will deliver. Mr. Chairman, we are asking for the opportunity to make one of the great icons of American broadcasting and communications part of the Comcast family. We promise to be reliable stewards of the national treasures of NBC and NBC News. It is a breathtaking and humbling moment in our history, and we hope we have your support. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Roberts. Mr. Zucker.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to testify here today. As the President and CEO of NBC Universal, I am proud to lead an iconic media company shaped by two great American brands, NBC and Universal. I am grateful for the opportunity to tell you how the proposed venture between Comcast and GE will help NBC Universal thrive and also benefit our local communities, our employees, and the American consumers who enjoy our content. In today's intensely competitive, unpredictable, and dynamic media markets, this deal is critical to realizing these benefits. The marketplace that I live in is a media free-for-all, a media Donnybrook, whether you look at the overall media marketplace, the cable channels, broadcast networks, or the Internet. There will be more change in our space in the next 5 years than there has been in the last 50. This deal will not change the fundamental competitive dynamic or the extraordinary rate of technological change, but it will help NBC Universal compete in the new media world. Why is this transaction good for NBC Universal, for the U.S. economy, and for the consumers we serve? My answer can be captured in two words: investment and innovation, both of which I believe are essential if we are to remain a vigorous competitor in the 21st century media market and a growing source of high-wage jobs in an economy starved for employment. First, investment. The creative programming that lies at the heart of our business is neither easy nor inexpensive to produce. The entertainment programming on our broadcast and cable networks will require investment this year of nearly $4.5 billion. Every year, we invest another $1 billion in news gathering and news production. An investment of $500 million annually makes Telemundo the leading U.S. producer of Spanish-language programming. In a highly competitive, unpredictable, and dynamic media marketplace, Comcast's desire to expand our business and invest in programming will benefit NBC Universal, the American consumer, and the U.S. economy. Also, with regards to investment, Comcast's written commitment to over-the-air broadcasting has been widely underappreciated. In addition, Comcast has expressed a willingness to play a constructive role in the business negotiations between broadcast stations and MVPDs. Those two positions could play a pivotal role in finding a sustainable new business model for the struggling broadcast business. Second, innovation. We believe Comcast's history of delivery, innovation, and technological vision will help us better serve the 21st century consumer. We must find a sustainable business model to meet consumer demands for access to programming anytime, anywhere. We need to be more nimble in taking advantage of new digital distribution capabilities, on demand, online, mobile, and beyond. This venture with Comcast positions NBCU to be a leading innovator in delivering content to consumers where they want it, when they want it, and how they want it. In this extraordinarily competitive industry, sustained investment and innovation will be the keys to remaining a vigorous competitor. This is not your father's media market. Less than 40 years ago, three companies enjoyed 90% of all television viewing. Oh, how simple it was. Today, the world could not be more different. Each of the five largest media companies in America now only account for between 5 and 10% of all viewing. And a multitude of smaller competitors actually account for half of all television viewing. The new NBCU's cable channel business, where we will add Comcast networks, will account for just 7% of total viewing and be fourth by revenue among owners of national cable networks. Television is also a shrinking proportion of the media market. People today choose not only between broadcast and cable television, but also increasingly the Internet, Xbox, iPhone, PlayStation, and so many other new platforms and technologies for their media choices. Very simply, this transaction will not change the tidal wave of competition inundating today's media market. The big winner here is the consumer. More investment leads to more and better content. More innovation leads to more access, anytime, anywhere. Let me close by saying how grateful I am for GE's excellent stewardship of NBC Universal. GE has invested more than $22 billion since 2000 and built NBC Universal into the diversified and vibrant broadcast, film, cable programming, and media company that we are today. With this deal, GE will have billions of dollars to invest in new technologies and jobs in its core businesses. I could not be more excited about the future of this company. This deal will give us the resources and the tools to innovate and adapt in an unpredictable media world and meet the needs of 21st century consumers. Thank you for the opportunity to testify, and I look forward to answering any questions that this subcommittee may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Zucker. Ms. Abdullah.
Hi, I'm very proud to be here. Oh, is this on?
There you go.
Hi. I'm very proud to represent WOW and the American Cable Association. We're a broadband competitor in five markets in the Midwest. 1 million of the households that we pass directly compete with Comcast in Michigan and Illinois. I know customers appreciate having competitive choice. They do not choose WOW because we're the low-cost provider. They choose us because we differentiate ourselves based on the service experience that we provide. Customers have recognized this. We've received 10 J.D. Power Awards for customer service. Just recently, they awarded us the first place provider of Internet, phone, and cable in the Consumer Reports. And I don't tell you about this recognition to brag, but to illustrate that when we have direct influence and control over operations, we can be very customer-centric and focus on what the customer needs and wants. Yet, as a buyer of content, both cable and online, we face a different set of challenges. We buy most of our content from a handful of large content providers who have significant market power and leverage. The prospect of having Comcast NBCU as the largest vertical integrator of content as my direct competitor does concern me, and it concerns me because the combined company will have powerful abilities and incentives to possibly hurt a competitor like us and increase our costs. I have these concerns because of current behaviors and experiences that we have today. Now, the reality is that whether the distribution medium is broadcast, cable, online, or mobile, video content is key. So content negotiations are critical for us, and the behaviors we experience today during those negotiations are things like price value. Not all content is created equal, yet content providers who have large market power come to the table with their network offerings packaged in a take it want, take it all or take it or leave it kind of fashion, meaning that low-value networks, not highly viewed or wanted by customers, are associated with or packaged with the high-value networks that we need to buy in order to compete. And the issues with this are several. One, we end up using channel space for networks customers don't want and aren't viewing, channel space we could give to independent networks, and it consumes our valuable bandwidth that we would rather allocate to advanced services that we know customers want, HD, video on demand, interactive, and especially faster online speeds. Then there's carriage availability. Content providers with large, significant market power can withhold or delay launch timing by slow rolling the negotiations. One example of this is for online content. The concept of TV Everywhere, which basically involves packaging cable networks and allowing them to be viewed by your broadband customers. I think Comcast brands there as Xfinity. We went to Comcast, we went to the other networks, and we asked for rights to access that programming for our broadband customers. To date, we've been denied that access. A cable example, we were negotiating with a network that Comcast has a significant investment in. During that negotiation, the network refused to include the rights to their advanced programming that they were developing. And the bottom line is this. We're not here to whine or ask for special advantages because we're the smaller guy. I believe in competition. As my peers here have said, it breeds creativity, innovation, and especially a clear focus on the customer. And I think our J.D. Power and Consumer Report ratings validate that. We simply ask for a thorough and thoughtful consideration of specific conditions that may be imposed so that we can continue to preserve and promote the competitive choice that we provide and that Congress sought in the 92 and 96 Acts. The types of conditions we would ask for are the following. The terms and conditions for access for content, whether it's cable, online, or otherwise, should be the same terms and conditions that are available to Comcast. And then business is business. If there is a time when discriminatory behavior occurs and market power is and leverage is exerted inappropriately, I really ask for a remedy structure that is meaningful and accessible for companies like WOW. The current retransmission consent and program access complaint procedures do not help us. An outside arbitration process does not help us. And the reasons are they're time-consuming. They're very costly. They don't ensure continued carriage while you're in dispute. And especially, they place the burden of proof on the complainant, who doesn't have the access to the data, since there's absolutely no pricing transparency. So to protect the competition and consumers from this combination, regulators must impose different and better remedies for us. And we look forward to participating in that process. Thanks for having me.
Thank you very much, Ms. Abdullah. Mr. Fiorelli.
Chairman Boucher and members of the subcommittee, my name is Michael Fiorelli, and I speak to you today as chair of the NBC Television Affiliates Board, representing some 200 independently owned local television stations. For more than 60 years now, the affiliates and NBC have worked together as partners. The result has been free and universally available local and national news, weather, sports, emergency information, and some of the highest quality programming. The question today is whether or not the benefits of this partnership produces for local viewers in your districts will thrive if and when Comcast owns NBC. The NBC Affiliates Board has been very pleased to hear Comcast's response to this key question. Steve Burke, the Chief Operating Officer of Comcast, has assured us on more than one occasion that the company's intent is to grow our partnership, providing free and over-the-air television service through the affiliates. In fact, also Comcast's desire to retain NBC's 10 owned and operated television stations in some of our country's largest cities is very important to us, and we support that. Ownership of these stations will provide Comcast with a direct stake in serving local television viewers, just as the affiliates have. This is a very positive start, but at this point, it is, in fact, just a start. The fact that never before has a major cable operator controlled one of the four major broadcast networks is here. The stakes for free local television service and for viewers are too high to leave this to statements alone. In the weeks ahead, the Affiliates Board and Comcast have work to do. Together, we hope to design and agree upon clear, specific, and enforceable conditions defining what it means in practice for Comcast to deliver on its promise to uphold the network affiliate partnership for free local television service that has served viewers so well for so long. We have Comcast's word on these principles, and now we look forward to getting to specifics such as those that have been proposed in the application. First, there must be protections in place to prevent the erosion of the NBC network through migration of popular NBC news, sports, and entertainment content and talent to cable channels or to other pay services. For example, consider the prospect, if you will, if NFL football games currently broadcast for free by NBC affiliates migrating to a Comcast sports channel. Or consider NBC nightly news moving to a paid channel. That would be an immediate and a significant loss to affiliates and to all of our viewers. The public and the affiliates also need assurances that Comcast will continue to invest in new and compelling sports, news, and entertainment programming for the NBC network. Secondly, Comcast must not interfere with the NBC affiliates' right to serve our local communities as the first point of availability of network programming. This long-standing principle serves the network, serves the affiliates and consumers by maintaining the broadcast medium with its unique reach and accessibility to viewers as a strong and economically viable platform provided free to all Americans. And thirdly, this transaction raises questions about retransmission consent. As you know, thanks to this committee and others in Congress, retransmission consent is a market-based mechanism that clearly works. It supports stations' investment in local and national programming. The Comcast-NBC transaction could threaten this essential economic foundation of NBC affiliates' localized services. It puts the station supplier of network programming and their single largest distributor under one roof. Simply put, Comcast should not use its control of the NBC network to undermine the market for retransmission consent of affiliate signals on Comcast systems. One way to address this concern is to keep network affiliation negotiations with the NBC network and to keep retransmission consent negotiations with Comcast Cable separate in the future as they are today. We are also considering other ways to preserve retransmission consent because of its vital role in the underpinning of the local services that we provide to communities. So you've heard briefly about three principal areas of concerns to the affiliates. Given your oversight role, we would hope and we would encourage you to encourage the FCC to adopt the necessary conditions to protect consumers' continued access to free, quality local television. Like the commitments Comcast has volunteered in its application, these conditions need to become part of the FCC's order and need to be binding. Comcast and the affiliates are off to a very promising start in fleshing out the principles which both of us consider very important. With concrete and enforceable safeguards and conditions, we believe this transaction can actually strengthen the ability of affiliates and NBC to serve our communities for many, many years to come. And we know from discussions with Comcast that Comcast shares these goals. And I thank you for the opportunity to be here today.
Thank you, Mr. Fiorelli. Dr. Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, for the opportunity to offer a public interest analysis of a merger that is unique in the history of the video market and will go a long way toward determining whether or not the future of video viewing in America is more competitive and consumer-friendly than the past. There is another side to the story. Comcast straddles the dominant video distribution platform of the 20th century as the nation's largest cable operator. And the emerging video distribution platform of the 21st century as the nation's largest broadband internet service provider. In its cable franchise service territories, the market share of Comcast in these two vital distribution platforms exceeds 50%, allowing it to acquire one of the nation's premier video content producers will radically alter the structure of the video marketplace, triggering a bevy of anti-competitive effects that will result in higher prices and fewer choices for consumers. Allowing Comcast to acquire NBC will increase the likelihood that the ugly business model of the cable cartel will be strengthened and extended to the Internet. There are huge horizontal problems with this merger. Broadcasters and cable companies have a natural competitive rivalry we witness every day. They argue about the price, channel location, and carriage of content. The rivalry is so intense that each side has attempted to enter the rival's market in an effort to diminish their market power. They are known as disruptive entrants in each other's markets. This merger would eliminate that primary line of conflict between two of the most important of these potential entrants. These two companies compete for audiences and advertisers in a dozen of the nation's most important local markets, serving about a fifth of the nation's population. There are more people in the markets where Comcast and NBC compete head-to-head through NBC O&Os than there are in markets where NBC O&Os own stations and Comcast is not present. There is more population that they compete for directly than they do not. These two companies compete in the video programming market, where Comcast regional sports and news production compete with NBC's news and sports production. Three-quarters of the regional sports networks that Comcast has rolled out are located in the markets where they compete directly with NBC for eyeballs and advertiser dollars. If that ain't competition, there is no such thing as competition. That's horizontal competition. These two companies compete in cyberspace, where NBC has funded an alternative distribution platform, Hulu, as well as numerous websites for its media properties. Comcast has launched its own video portal and has big plans to expand that competition. That is head-to-head competition in cyberspace. That is horizontal competition. By combining its distribution market power, that 50% market share, that 24% national share of cable viewers, with a huge portfolio of content, the merger would dramatically increase the incentive and ability of Comcast to raise prices, discriminate in carriage, foreclose and block competitive entry, and force larger programming bundles onto other systems. Those strategies raise prices and reduce choices, as you've heard from Ms. Abdullah. The merger has so many anti-competitive and anti-consumer effects that it just can't be fixed. They can't be unraveled. The claim that there is enough other competition to prevent these anti-competitive effects is based on the denial of the existence of a well-recognized $80 billion multi-channel video market. That is a marketplace that we recognize and we can evaluate. The likely response in that market to the creation of a giant that has both massive content and massive distribution is to goad the other members of the market to bulk up in the same way. We will lose more choices in that market. The claim that FCC oversight under current law or Comcast promises to obey the law for a change will protect the public is absurd. The FCC rules have failed to undermine, eliminate, prevent the stranglehold of the cable operators to date, and there's no reason to believe that they will be better able to tame the video giant that will result from this merger. Comcast public interest promises do not even acknowledge the existence of these horizontal competition problems, not to mention offer serious remedies. The temporary band-aids that have been offered cannot cure the long-term structural injuries that would result from this merger. For decades, Congress has labored to bring consumers price competition in the video market by opening the door to different business models and different technologies. But in every instance, key policy mistakes were made that allowed the cable industry to preserve and extend its market power. This is the first big policy test for the Internet as the alternative video platform that can compete with cable. If policymakers allow this merger to go forward, the prospects for a more competition-friendly, consumer-friendly, multi-channel video market will be dealt a setback. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cooper. Mr. Thayer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, for inviting me here today to testify. My name is Adam Thayer, and I'm the president of the Progress and Freedom Foundation here in Washington. Although we are still early in this process, there's already been a great deal of hand-wringing and even some dire predictions about the pending merger of Comcast and NBC Universal. I hope to try to put this proposed marriage in some historical context and explain why the deal certainly won't have the detrimental impact that some critics fear, and also try to explain why it might even be one potential model for how to sustain traditional media going forward. But first, let's remember that we've been here before. Paranoid predictions of a media merger apocalypse have accompanied the announcements of many previous deals, from AOL Time Warner to News Corp DirecTV to even XM Sirius. In these cases and most others, the sky is falling claims typically proved to be greatly overstated. The only harm that one could reasonably claim came from most of those mergers was not to consumers or content providers, but to the merging firms themselves and their shareholders. That's because many mergers simply fail to create the sort of synergies and benefits originally hoped for and consequently die of natural causes over time. Other firms, however, have found ways to make deals work and deliver some important new services that previously were unimaginable or simply too expensive to offer alone. Regardless, the point here is that we'll never know what works unless we permit marketplace experimentation with new and innovative business models. Second, the fear that Comcast NBCU will act as a gatekeeper over video content is also largely overblown, especially in light of the preemptive concessions that they've already made on program access and carriage. But it's important to realize that the merger will only marginally affect vertical integration in the cable marketplace. Currently, the percentage of cable channels owned by video distributors is in the single digits, and even after this merger, it will only be in the teens. Stated differently, the vast majority of cable channels will be independent of Comcast NBCU control. More importantly, it's hard to believe that the new firms would restrict its content to just Comcast-owned distribution networks, since they'd be losing eyeballs, advertisers, and revenues that accompany the carriage of their content on other platforms. Likewise, it would make little sense for the firm to block new or competing channels on their own platform, since they would incur the wrath of programmers and the viewing public alike. And those channels will likely find a home elsewhere, which could incentivize subscribers to switch video service providers. Indeed, the really great thing about the modern media marketplace is that there's always another place for consumers to turn to find what they want. Comcast faces increasingly robust competition in the video programming marketplace from satellite and telco providers, as well as from a variety of internet-based video providers. And NBC Universal's stable of programming, while quite impressive, is a mere trickle in the ocean of content that consumers can choose from. Meanwhile, consumers are increasingly cutting the cable cord altogether and instead getting the video they want from a bewildering array of online video services today. Netflix, Hulu, Juiced, Roku, Apple, the Sony PlayStation Store, the Microsoft Xbox Store, and many others online sites such as YouTube, Vimeo, and Justin TV offer a mix of professional and amateur content. In sum, there's never been so much competition for our eyes and ears, and audience and advertising dollars have become increasingly fragmented as a result. Finally, we need to realize that the ongoing digital revolution is upending many traditional business models, especially advertising supported over-the-air broadcasting, and that alliances like Comcast NBCU may be one blueprint for how traditional media operators can evolve and compete going forward. With both the FCC and FTC currently investigating whether journalism is in trouble and what it might take to save the news, many media economists and industry analysts seem to agree that at least some degree of consolidation or collaboration might be necessary. Consider last week's news that NBC Universal saw quarterly profits plunge by a whopping 30% in the fourth quarter of 2009. This is indicative of the general downturn the entire media sector has been experiencing as of late. Why not then allow Comcast to try to help NBCU out and try to get back on track instead of forcing them to make it on their own in such a radically uncertain future? And it goes without saying that Comcast might be better positioned to protect NBC Universal's copyrighted content from digital piracy, at least over their own pipes. So those concerned about the future of broadcasting and local news should remember that news, and local news and broadcast news in particular, isn't cheap. Unless we want to embark on massive government subsidization to bail out traditional media providers, Congress and regulatory officials must be willing to grant private media operators the flexibility to restructure their business affairs so they can continue to provide important public needs while also turning a profit. That can't happen unless we allow media markets to evolve and let operators experiment with new business models and ownership structures. Although there are no guarantees, deals like Comcast NBC Universal may be one model that help firms create, extend, and then also monetize their media content going forward. But again, Regulatory flexibility is crucial so we can figure out what works and what doesn't. Thank you again for inviting me here today.
Thank you very much, Mr. Thayer, and we express our appreciation to all of the witnesses for their comments over the Internet has become a useful and attractive alternative to viewing those programs over cable television. Concerns have been raised, including some this morning, about the fact that the Comcast-NBC combination would place Comcast in a position to inhibit the online viewing of television programs for a very large amount of television content. That concern is heightened by the TV Everywhere model that Comcast and Time Warner Cable have now launched, through which the online TV programs are made available only to the subscribers to the cable television service itself. With regard to TV Everywhere, smaller cable companies, including Mrs. Abdullah's, as she just indicated, have in instances been denied access to the content that is being made available on TV Everywhere. And there are questions about whether programs that are offered over the air today and made available through the NBC.com website for online viewing might in the future migrate into TV Everywhere, a very real concern a number of people have expressed. The concern about the Comcast position, enabling it to potentially inhibit the availability of TV fare over the Internet, is also heightened by the fact that for at least some period of time last year, users of Boxy, which is a software application that enables people to see online television programs on their television sets, not just on their computers, but actually on their TV sets, giving them a very seamless experience, similar to what they would get from cable TV. But those Boxy users were apparently blocked from being able to view the Hulu-delivered programs on their TV sets. And presumably that blocking came from Hulu. And I would note that NBC Universal is a part owner and one of the founders of Hulu. And so, Mr. Roberts and Mr. Zucker, my question to you is this. What response do you have to those concerns? And what assurance can you give to us that when this combination takes place, there will not be an inhibition put in place that would limit the amount of online video content that viewers can see? Mr. Roberts, would you like to start?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and appreciate the opportunity to talk about some of those issues. First of all, as has been mentioned previously, we have helped create the broadband experience that consumers enjoy today. Some of the work out of cable labs going back a decade was one of the first to create high-speed broadband. It's the fastest growing part of Comcast is our broadband business. In fact, we just complete or are in the process of completing a nearly $1 billion upgrade to create wideband. And if you say, what do you do with wideband? Right now, I don't have a great answer except that at 50 megabits or 100 megabits a second, I trust that there are great entrepreneurs out there to come up with the answers, and we want to be a company on the leading edge. So we think this is absolutely one of the most exciting areas, and I've said consistently for several years that we believe video over the Internet is one of those applications that requires more speed and justifies the investments that we're making in wideband and broadband. So we think it is a friend, not a foe. And that position is demonstrated by the surge of usage and the amount of bits that consumers continue to consume each month. And it's growing at a very fast rate. So in this transaction, if you look at the facts, there are 30 billion views of video on the Internet last month. NBC was less than 1% of that. Hulu, of which NBC is one of four partners, I think is around 4%. Comcast is less than 0.5% of any of our video-owned content assets being viewed on the Internet.
Well, Mr. Roberts, in my time is running out rapidly here. Let me just sort of pinpoint a couple of key concerns. Ms. Abdullah has said that she has been denied access to the content available on TV everywhere. What's your response to that?
I'm not aware exactly what she's referring to, but...
Do you agree that she ought to be able to get access to it on reasonable terms?
Yes, and she, I believe, can by going to... The biggest proponent of TV everywhere has been...
Okay, well, let me just accept the yes.
Okay, fair enough.
The second key question that I have is this. What about Boxy? Mr. Zucker, you probably are in a better position to answer that. Did Hulu block the Boxy users from access to the Hulu programs?
Well, this was a decision made by the Hulu management what Boxy was doing was illegally taking the content that was on Hulu without any business deal. And, you know, we have several distributors, actually many distributors of the Hulu content that we have legal distribution deals with. So we don't preclude distribution deals. What we preclude are those who illegally take that content.
Well, would you have negotiations with Boxy upon request?
We have always said that we're open to negotiations.
All right. One further question, and my time has expired. Can the two of you offer to us assurance that the programs that are delivered over the air by NBC today and are then available on the NBC.com website for online viewing will not migrate into the TV Everywhere format so that they then would be available only to people who have a cable subscription? Can you give us that assurance?
Yes.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your answers to those questions. The gentleman from Florida, Mr. Stearns, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Cooper, you've testified before our committee before many times, and I thank you for coming. Ms. Abdullah, we sort of all on your side. You're the small person in this big room here, so we're sympathetic to you. So I understand that you don't oppose a merger, you just want conditions in place. Would that be an ample way to say your opinion?
That's a fair statement.
Okay.
Yes.
And Dr. Cooper, though, that you're pretty vociferously against this merger. Is that fair? Just yes or no?
I believe, I'm against the merger. I don't think you can unravel the anti-competitive.
Okay. And you've been here before, and I know you've testified against other mergers, so I'm going to ask you succinctly if you can tell us that, I mean, you say control over production and distribution of information has critical implications for society and democracy. Well, you all agree with that. I mean, no one will disagree with that. The problem is that the proposed deal before us doesn't speak to all of production and all of distribution. So when you make that statement, you know, Comcast, NBC is not all of production, not all of distribution. I mean, you and I both agree there's diversity of news and entertainment from all kinds of different things. I don't have to go into and enumerate them, but how could Comcast, in your opinion, very succinctly now, control production distribution, to go back to your statement, overall? I mean, just in one or two sentences.
I'm not worried about overall. I'm worried about in the specific local markets where they have market power. So in 12 of this nation's markets, Comcast and NBC compete head-to-head for eyeballs, for advertisers. They, in many of those markets, they produce programming, news programming, and sports programming, marquee programming.
Okay, in those 12 markets, what will happen if this merger comes? Tell me specifically what worst-case scenario.
Worst-case scenario, one of those entities abandons the market and ceases to try to win eyeballs. Today, they both vigorously try to win eyeballs. Tomorrow, I've lost a competitor.
And which one of those markets, of those 12, you think it's most likely, in your opinion?
They're all good candidates, but they're all important markets.
Come on, just one of those 12 that we can highlight as we're scared of.
Well, the premier one is, of course, Philadelphia.
Okay, Philadelphia, that's where they are. So
yep.
Philadelphia, so that's a market, and this is going to happen in 2 years, 5 years, 1 year, 2 days, one?
Well, these are long-term structural changes. And
which would be
in
over
those
5 to 10 years,
In those markets, we have a record of Comcast making it difficult for competitors to enter. You've heard from those people.
Yeah, okay.
They have withheld their sports programming.
Okay, I got
slowed down, driven hard.
All right, Dr. Cooper, you made your point.
Prices.
Ms. Abdullah, what do you think? Do you agree with him? Do you think that's true, that in these 12 markets we're going to lose, Comcast will dominate and will lose competition? I mean, he's buttressing your argument in a way, so he's on your side, even though you wanted to condition.
Well, I think we're speaking of different things. He's speaking of the 15 markets and the O&Os.
And you're speaking of your own.
And I'm speaking of, as a competitor in markets.
Okay. Mr. Thayer, what would you say to Dr. Cooper's comment?
Well, I think the problem with this story is that right now you see Comcast actually losing share in those markets. And
in those 12 markets that Dr.
In some of them. I can't speak for all of
before
them.
Before the merger.
We know that telco operators have taken away a lot of that market share. Satellite operators are still highly competitive. And, you know, I hear a lot of concern about, you know, advertisers and viewer options from Mark. I mean, I'm sure the advertisers will be pleased to hear Mark so concerned about their welfare. You know, they're actually doing all right. They have a lot of options. I have some data that I presented in my testimony showing just how many different avenues advertisers can go to and take their dollars to. And in terms of viewers, I mean, they're shifting their eyeballs and ears all around these days. So it's hard for me to believe that this is going to be some sort of a nightmare Chicken Little scenario where this guy's going to fall in these markets.
All right. Ms. Abdullah, I'm coming back to you. You're sort of the person here. Given that Comcast would not be gaining any new cable properties to compete with your company, what advantage would this company gain from withholding content from you or your customers?
What advantage? Well,
yeah. Why would they
I
want to
can't
do it?
Offer the same content, if I don't have access to the content, where does my customer go? To my competitor, to Comcast.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Roberts, you might want to comment on either her comment or Dr. Cooper's.
Well, I go back to the principle here. First of all, the content's going to be made available to our competitors, is available today. In the last 2 years, Comcast has lost nationally over about 1.5 million customers, while phone and satellite and the wide open west of the country have added over 7 million. In fact, the second and third largest distributors of multi-channel video in the country today are two satellite companies. So there is a very competitive market. One of the reasons we want to get in more invested in content is we see the value of that content growing. And I think the premise of the way you phrase the question I agree with, which is we will be well served to make that content available to all the growing players in the marketplace. So I think this will ultimately lead to more innovation, more content creation. We see it as a growing business. I'm sure somewhere we'll talk about the intellectual property and how to protect it. We are very much focused on that same issue. And I think we recognize that this is a very competitive video distribution marketplace, and this is an opportunity to participate in the growing part. And as the Internet grows, as the Chairman asked, we want to see the content available and growing for the consumer, because that's where the consumer wants to be.
May I respond?
Sure.
To that, just clarify
very quickly, Ms. Abdullah.
Pardon me?
Very quickly, please. The
okay,
time,
it's
time
not
is
just
running.
About withholding content. It's also about putting restrictions and conditions on how we offer that content. Those are two things that we need to consider here, because that happens as well.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stearns. The gentleman from California, Mr. Waxman, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Roberts, NBC has been a longtime proponent of vigorous protection for the intellectual property rights of content creators and owners. Mr. Zucker and I have had an opportunity to discuss the need for more robust action by broadband providers in protecting content available online. Online content theft is a serious problem. It's a drain on our economy and one that I'm committed to addressing. If your transaction is approved and you find that you own NBC's valuable content catalog, can you tell us what actions you're considering to reduce content theft online? And secondly, will you ask other broadband providers that seek access to NBC content to adopt measures to reduce content theft?
I think we absolutely recognize the vital nature of protecting the licensed, legitimate, you know, non-theft model that has what's propelled NBC Universal to where it is today and every other owner of content. In the distribution business, we also rely on licensed content to be the successful part of our business. So I think we now have double the incentive to figure this issue out better than it's figured out today. Specifically, I think there have been technological advancements in the last couple of years that are going to make it more likely that we can cooperate. And to your very specific question, would we encourage the rest of the other broadband providers and distributors to try to find solutions here? The answer is yes. We will now be an active member of NCTA, MPAA, and other industry trade groups that are focused on these questions. I think it's vital that we have cooperative solution. We obviously, on one hand, have privacy concerns and copyright protection concerns. On the other hand, we want it by having such a 33,000 employees at NBC Universal that I've got to worry about and our 100,000 employees at Comcast Cable, it's in my interest and I think the consumer's interest to continue the licensed model and find solutions that are acceptable.
I appreciate that. On this issue about fair competition, the Communications Act prohibits cable companies from requiring a financial interest in any program service as a condition for carriage or forcing a programmer to grant an exclusive to the cable provider as a condition of carriage. The idea behind this prohibition is to protect independent programmers from being forced to accept unfair terms as the price for being distributed and seen by viewers. Do you agree that this kind of prohibition makes sense?
I do, and we have abided by that prohibition since 1992.
There was a statement by Steve Burke during a program carriage dispute between Comcast and the NFL, and Mr. Burke, who was Comcast's chief operating officer, stated that Comcast treats its own programming services as siblings as opposed to strangers. Do you agree with Mr. Burke's statement? Does Comcast treat its own programming services differently than those outside of the Comcast family?
I'm not familiar with the context of that remark, so if I may, Mr. Burke is...
We'll put his statement aside. Do you treat your programming services differently than those outside of the Comcast family?
I think that what he may have been referring to is as the employees of the company and just how, as chief operating officer, he's concerned with both parts of the company and the welfare of the assets and the people. But specifically, we have six out of every seven channels that Comcast carries, we do not have any financial interest in. The competitiveness of DirecTV, WOW, Dish Network, Verizon Fios, AT&T UVerse requires us to have the most compelling product as fairly and exciting presented to the consumer as possible.
So and you're going to treat your content and other content not produced by your
We have to get the best content, otherwise people are going to not want our product. And I think that's what is driving us from a competitive standpoint is to how to have the best offerings possible.
Let me ask Mr. Zucker, as a programmer interested in bringing NBC's programming to as many people as possible, are you expecting Comcast to look out for its own? And if so, would you expect such a preference to be good for NBC?
The fact is that we would like our content to be as widely seen as possible. So our relationship with every distributor is the same, that we would like them, though they don't always, carry all of our networks and all of our content. And we have those conversations all the time with all distributors.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I know my time has expired, but I want to point out that companies like people naturally have an interest in taking special care of family members. But in looking at this transaction, I think the FCC needs to analyze carefully what such potential favoritism might mean for competition from independent programmers and ultimately a consumer choice.
Thank you very much, Mr. Waxman. The gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Booyer, is recognized for 7 minutes.
Thank you very much. I have I've worked hard to do my due diligence to examine this from all sides. So, Mr. Roberts, what I'm going to ask of you, if you can grab your pen, I have six questions that I'm going to ask. And you don't have to give very long answers, because you and I have had very good discussions with regard to the word trust. You can't beat up broadcasters for your entire career of Comcast, and all of a sudden you become one without giving assurances or commitments. So let's go ahead and go down the line. With regard to your testimony on program access rules, you have now given the assurance that you'll abide by them even regardless of what the court may do. Does that commitment apply even after the rules sunset? That's my first question. The second question is that as I speak with the affiliates, it seems to me that you could fairly easily even get around the rule even though if there's a commitment. For example, a local NBC affiliate could significantly raise the price for all Comcast video competitors in that market for retransmission of a station signal. But for Comcast, this would be basically an accounting charge from one corporate affiliate to another. What can you do to assure that Comcast will not use its control of the NBCU to raise the rates for all its competitors to pay for this valuable must-have programming? That's my second question. Please also recognizing that if, in fact, that local market it becomes, you upset the market rates, that does have an impact upon smaller cable operators likewise. That's my second. My third is with regard to the issue on price. It does appear that you have the potential to gain a significant amount of leverage with your video distribution competitors for the price of access to these channels. Now, you might offer them access to programming, but at what price that effectively forecloses them from access or raise the provider's cost structure so they can't compete? Will you commit, at least with respect to the vast NBCU programming that you will that you now control, that will control, to maintain for some period of years the programming prices in the current deals? After all, these were negotiated at arm's length before the vertical integration, and so they should reflect the market rates. Secondly, on this question, on my third question, will you agree to so-called most favored nation status for similarly situated purchases that are now integrated programming? That is, will you commit all similarly situated video competitors of yours will automatically get the best price that you will make available to them? My fourth question, with regard to the NBCU vast array of films in the film library, what commitments will you make about competitor access to valuable programming, which is essential for video on-demand services? Next issue is on advertising. I understand Comcast does not currently allow its video competitors to advertise their services on Comcast cable on your cable channels. Do you intend to extend this policy to all NBCU networks and programs after the deal? And if you do, well, let's just hear what your commitment's going to be on that, because you understand what this could do. The last is with regard to, I'm not aware of any commitments that Comcast has made regarding the availability of Comcast and NBCU programming for distribution online. The ability of consumers to enjoy their favorite programming online or to take it with them on various devices is the frontier that you and I spoke about. Will Comcast make a commitment that it will not deny its video distribution rivals access to the NBCU broadcast or cable programming for online distribution? Assuming that the competitor is willing to pay a fair market rate, will Comcast commit not to give its online properties preferential treatment? For example, by making a really hot show available to a competitor for online distribution after Comcast customers have already enjoyed it first? I await your reply.
Okay. I'm going to do my very best, and I hope you'll bear with me that there were a lot of questions there, and I appreciate you've covered a lot of ground. I think what we said in my opening statement, which you may have caught some of or maybe not all of, is that we are prepared to discuss with the FCC either the sunsetting or the any litigation that exists on the program access rules and program carriage rules, having them remain in place and after this transaction is completed. So I think we will continue to abide and have lived with, and it's not a motivation for this deal, is to see a massive change in that oversight that the FCC has on our conduct of behavior. Again, I want to stress the point to underscore that it is not the motivation for this deal to suddenly take a CNBC off of DirecTV or in some way try to change that relationship, because frankly, those are the second and third largest distributors, the fastest growing distributors are the telcos. And the fact is that that's part of the growth in Mr. Zucker's business.
All right, that's
and that's
number what one. Appeals number, to us. Number two.
Okay. Affiliates rates for retransmissions and smaller MSOs. I'm not totally sure I understood all the implications of that question. Could you perhaps just talk about that a little bit?
We're a little worried about when in our office when you talked about, well, the NBC affiliates are going to feel good about what I'm going to do. They may get better rates. Well, when you do that, you're going to change what happens within that local market, and there could potentially be cost shifting. And what type of assurances, not only that, but also some of the affiliates that I've spoken to, it's this corporate accounting.
So first of all, I hope you, as I was, encouraged by the head of the NBC Affiliates Board statements of that we're off to an encouraging start in terms of trying to address some of the fundamental issues in a troubled business because of audience share declines, technological change. Broadcast television is going through a lot of change. We've heard about retransmission consent, which I think is the essence of this question. By being at the end of this deal, about 80% a cable company and about 20% a content company, we are still going to have a large concern about cable rates and what is the right model and the right answer. Sitting here today, I don't have the perfect answer to the dynamic changes that are going through the industry, but the question I think at its essence, are we prepared to try to play a constructive role in the future of broadcast television and recognize its vital importance? We're making a huge bet by buying NBC. At the same time, there are the opportunities to revisit what's the right answer there, and I hope by being in both sides, we can truly play a role in helping make that happen.
But my time is running out, and if you can hit these commitments really quick.
Let me price for the channel.
Go to three.
Okay.
Just
program prices in the current deals. I can assure you that all the existing contracts that NBC has, which I have not had access to see, we don't intend to abrogate any agreements or attempt to
okay.
do so.
Okay. Number four.
Films, competitors, access. I don't know. I've just met the Universal folks. But again, it is not the motivation. I'm sure we're going to try to figure out how to make the best movies. You have many partners when you make a film, all the actors and the writers and the talent and the creative folks, and you're going to try to maximize the revenues as a fiduciary of that film. And if other folks want access to it, we're certainly in favor of that.
Mr. Bowyer and Mr. Roberts, let me suggest that, Mr. Roberts, you submit the balance of those answers in writing. We're going to be submitting some additional questions to you in writing anyway, and we have such a number of members still to ask questions in limited time, I think we'll move on. Thank you very much, Mr. Bowyer. The gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Dingell, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen and ladies, I'm going to request that a lot of these questions be answered yes or no. This doesn't indicate any lack of respect, but it indicates a very important need to conserve time under the very limited process that we proceed. To Mr. Roberts, will Comcast commit not to tie together retransmission consent payments with payments for network programming provider under an affiliation agreement, yes or no?
Can you repeat the question? I'm sorry.
Will Comcast commit not to tie together retransmission consent payments with payments for network programming provider under an affiliation agreement, yes or no?
We will not do what you said, I believe. I'm sorry. There's a couple names in there, Mr.
I'll ask the record be kept open. You can give us a more finished answer to that at the appropriate time.
Appreciate that.
And I hope you don't regard that I'm trying to take advantage of you. Now, again, Mr. Roberts, will Comcast commit not to force network affiliates to accept unfavorable affiliation agreement provisions to obtain market-based retransmission consent payments, yes or no?
We will not force them to take unfair deals.
And again, I'll ask that the record be kept open so that you can amplify on that. Again, Mr. Roberts, does Comcast's public interest filing with FCC include proper assurances that Comcast will not migrate critical network programming away from free over-the-air broadcasting to Comcast's cable properties? Again, yes or no?
We will not. That is not the motivation.
And again,
and I believe our filing does address that, yes.
And I want to clear, these questions are asked with all respect and affection. Mr. Roberts, again, upon approval of Comcast's joint venture with NBC Universal, will Comcast commit to respecting collective bargaining agreements for its employees and the process by which they are reached, yes or no?
Yes.
Again, Mr. Roberts, further, will Comcast put up roadblocks to first or initial contract negotiations with the unions, yes or no?
No.
Mr. Roberts, finally, how will Comcast view arbitration of first contract negotiations? Should they break down between Comcast and employees seeking to form a union? Will Comcast support or oppose such actions?
In terms of mediation or some third party?
I'm talking about arbitration. You can use the word mediation interchangeably with it.
If there's a contract breakdown?
Yes.
If there's creative ways to find solutions, we don't want to have a breakdown. So if that's a helpful way to go, it's something we'll consider, sure.
Now, these questions to Ms. Abdullah and Mr. Cooper. In 25 words or less, how do you see the proposed joint venture between Comcast and NBC Universal as affecting the online video market? Starting with Mr. Cooper.
Frankly, we see it as an effort to extend the market division agreement that has existed between cable operators and physical space into cyberspace. That is the explicit intention of TV Everywhere. The statement that they will not use NBC properties to reinforce that does not answer our concern.
Thank
because
you.
NBC will stop developing alternative
I'm going to platforms. Request Ms. Abdullah give us her comments.
I'm concerned, sir, for two reasons. One, we have had a recent experience where we have not been granted the rights for online product. That's number one. And number two, I'm concerned that the current video model, where it's a take it or leave it, here's the high price that you're going to pay, gets extended to the online broadband customer base as well.
Mr. Roberts, do you have a comment? 25 words or less.
I think that the internet is a nascent market. I think that TV Everywhere, just to be really clear, is meant to say if you're subscribing the way it was presented to us from HBO and Time Warner, if you can get the show, if you're a customer of, say, HBO on television and you now want to watch it on the PC, this enables that to happen, and I don't believe there's any impediments to Ms. Abdullah being able to have the same access from Time Warner. Those are the principles that were publicly stated and that we thought made a lot of sense.
Thank you. Now, this goes again to Mr. Roberts. Dr. Cooper asserts that a lack of competitive pressure has failed to produce any appreciable downward pressure on cable rates since 1983. In addition, Comcast will arguably be incentivized by virtue of vertical integration to charge competitors more for must-have content, thereby raising cable rates for consumers. What commitments does Comcast intend to make to prevent such abuses?
Well, I think that, as I said, we're still 80% a cable company, so our eye is very much still in that perspective, Mr. Dingell. Number two, I don't think the deal changes anything in that regard. NBC has great content and charges the best price that it can get from its customers, and I'm not sure that that our incentive is any different given the two companies coming together. I think that the quality of the content and the technology that's changed in the last several years is part of the answer, but I think it's a broader industry question, not necessarily specific to this deal.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I know my time is up, but I think mercy requires that Ms. Abdullah and Mr. Cooper be able to comment, starting with Ms. Abdullah. Do you have a comment on that?
I have a comment on the previous comment that we've not been denied access. Comcast, it's not about Time Warner only. Comcast provides networks on their TV Everywhere platform. We asked Comcast specifically for the rights, and we got sort of excuses like it's not ready for launch, even though it's been launched to 14 million of their households. We were told there's technical issues. We're technically capable of authenticating it. So there are issues of content being withheld today.
Thank you. Mr. Cooper, very quickly.
Comcast's sob story about losing cable subscribers is a dog that doesn't hunt. In the past few years, they have shifted to triple play, increased the total number of subscribers they have across their items, increased the price of cable, increased the margin on their cable customers. That is inconsistent with a market that is forcing them to lower prices. They are counting the wrong thing, the thing they're not really interested in anymore.
Thank you. My time's up.
Thank you very much, Chairman Dingell. The gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Markey, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. I think we have to just continue this conversation. It's obviously at the center of what this merger represents. So, as you know, I've introduced network neutrality legislation, and clearly the concern here is that when a company that has the wire going into the home merges with a company that has all of NBC's, Universal's content, that there could be a temptation to discriminate against others. And again, going out in the future, we are concerned about the proverbial kid in the garage, you know, that's got that great idea. We've got a concern about the kid that thinks up the idea of avatar.com TV. Could be a big concept right now. And it's not owned by Comcast or NBC. And so we have to make sure that it doesn't get discriminated against because it's not an NBC idea. It's not a Comcast idea. So how can we enshrine these principles of non-discrimination against those great new ideas from having access to the pipes that go into people's homes that are controlled by Comcast, Mr. Roberts? And that goes to the question of network neutrality and what kind of guarantees we can get that those other ideas are going to be protected.
Well, as you know, Mr. Markey, there's a procedure taking place at the FCC right now on this very question of net neutrality. And as you know, as you've said, you've got potential legislation in this committee and in the Congress. So I would first want to point out that I think it, whatever you do, if you're really trying to make that protection or achieve that goal, that it's going to have to apply across the board. And whether that's to all providers, what levels of the Internet, what about wireless, the world is changing and converging and evolving very, very quickly. So I, again, believe that this particular transaction doesn't really have the potential, in my opinion, to change that kid in the garage or that avatar.tv.com or whatever the example one wants to pick, because let's just say Google today is over 50% of all the video views of the 30 billion views that took place last month.
Will you commit to not creating a different standard for access by Avatar TV to the Comcast platform? Will you accept the principles of non-discrimination?
We have accepted and voluntarily, we may have a disagreement on whether there should be a law and what that does specifically, how it's interpreted down the road and what that does to investment. Here we're investing in DOCSIS 3.0 wideband without any applications. We're counting on that kid in the garage. We had the same questions many years ago. What about video gaming over the Internet? Are you going to support it or not? It's a huge part of what drives broadband are all these new applications. And so, yeah, I believe that it is not in our business interest.
Do you believe that there should be any conditions which are attached to this merger at all?
We've said that we've identified a new, I don't know, at least 10 commitments that get involved with independence of NBC News, to program access applying to retransmission consent. What I testified this morning earlier was that if for some reason the rules or program access are struck down by the courts, we would continue, wouldn't have a conversation, have a commitment with the FCC to have them continued, because that's not a plan we plan to change. We've talked about children's programming, free over-the-air broadcast.
My greatest concern going forward is that the Internet is this incredibly chaotic generator of creativity and new jobs in our society. That's who we have to be in the 21st century as a nation. And it's very important that there be no disincentives to that young creative person, the thousands of them across the country, the tens of thousands that can create that new product to get it into the homes of American people, to feel that there was a barrier, there was a block, that they couldn't get in. There was one standard for NBC, Universal, and Comcast programming, and another standard perhaps for other powerful content providers, but for that smaller creative person that really has to make the breakthrough, that they won't be able to do it. And I think in the end, that would hurt our economic competitiveness, because broadband, to a very large extent, is a proxy, as a word, for 21st century American competitiveness for the 3% of the population of the world that we represent. And we have to make sure that all of that creativity gets unleashed, because that is something we have to brand globally. So that's the conversation I think we have to have going forward. And this agreement that you have really should be a model to ensure that that becomes who we think of ourselves as a nation. So we thank all of you for being here today. And I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your indulgence in giving me extra time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Markey. The gentleman from Washington State, Mr. Inslee, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts. I'm told that in May 2007, Comcast obtained the broadcast rights for the Portland Trail Blazers. And at the time, the public was told that they would be available to through competitors. Instead, the Blazer broadcasting rights was used to run ads extorting satellite subscribers to switch to Comcast because it offered Blazer telecasts and the satellite providers did not. It's now been 2.5 years and still there's no deal to allow the conveyance of those rights. This leads me to suggest we ought to think about spiffing up our rules on how to deal with those access rights. And there's an arbitration procedure now that some have suggested is not adequate to the task of today and has not worked. I wanted to ask you and Ms. Abdullah if we should consider bringing those access procedures up to speed, for instance, by requiring continuation of coverage during the arbitration process, or having limits on the period of time it takes to reach a resolution, and or changing the burden of proof and giving parties discovery of, in fact, the contractual relationships with others. Mr. Roberts, Ms. Abdullah, could you address that consideration?
Let me go first. First of all, in the my understanding of Portland is we would love to have satellite carry that channel. We don't have an ability to begin an arbitration process to ask them to carry it. They're not bound by those rules. It's the other way around. And so I don't believe they have availed themselves, because I'm not sure that they have wanted to do that. I don't know what their motivation would be. So any change that you might have to the program access rules in general, I'm not sure would affect that particular situation. But just for the record, we have tried on numerous occasions to get that content carried by satellite and would welcome any way we can get that worked out. As to the program access rules in general, I just want to, you know, start. They were written in 92. They were at a time when I think probably over 50% of all the programming channels were owned by cable companies, and cable at that time did not have satellite competition or telco competition or wide open west type competition. It did not exist. Today, I think about 15, according to the FCC, about 15% of the channels are owned by vertically integrated companies. So there's a big change in the market over the last 18 years or so. But I think any revisiting should again go across the whole industry, and we'd welcome that. I'm not sure it's specific to this deal, but it's probably something that the FCC from time to time or Congress from time to time should look at. That's part of the question of whether the rules are still necessary given where the market is, what's happening with other forms of distribution. But I think that we have no problem with, you know, the FCC has said it wants to review how it timely resolves some of these matters. And the new chairman, I think, has sort of said the institution needs to look at how it processes things differently than past FCCs. And we welcome that kind of institutional review and want to be a constructive part of that
process. Thank you. Ms. Abdullah?
I can't obviously comment on why DISH has not, or Satellite has not been able to get a deal for the sports. I can assume it's because of the price. And the reason I assume that is because we recently went through a negotiation in Chicago for Comcast Regional Sports Network. When we came to the table to negotiate, we had a high single-digit increase. They had a high double-digit increase. We were about $2 million apart, getting nowhere in the negotiation. So we said, we'll go to arbitration, thinking that was a remedy for us. Quickly found out that it is not. It was going to cost about $1 million just to get the ball rolling. It could go on for months, up to 18 or more months. During that time period, there was no requirement that the service continue during the dispute. And the burden of proof was going to be placed on us to show that we're not getting a fair and equitable rate. Well, we can't do that because there's no price transparency. There's no market rationalization for the prices that we pay. So yes, do I think it needs to be absolutely reviewed and reformed and restructured so that there are time limits, the cost is not egregious, and out of the reach of smaller operators, that the burden of proof goes on the programmer, the content provider who is setting the price, for them to prove that it's decent and it's fair and it's market-based, the timing, that there's a set timing for the arbitration process. Otherwise, we have no remedy. We have no place to go if we hit loggerheads and we can't come to an agreement. And we absolutely need that to be fair and competitive.
Thank you very much, Mr. Inslee and Ms. Abdullah. We are facing a bit of a time problem now. We are scheduled between 1 and 1:15 to have another series of four votes. And then this subcommittee will have to vacate this room because at 2 o'clock there will be a hearing involving Secretary Sebelius on these premises. So I'm going to ask members if they will voluntarily keep their questions to about 3 minutes. And that way we can get as far through the list of members still to ask questions as possible. The gentlelady from Tennessee, Ms. Blackburn, is recognized for such time as she may consume, hopefully no more than 3 minutes.
Well, I'll tell you what I'll do, Mr. Chairman. Why don't I lay my questions out and then allow you all to respond to me in writing, and that will save some time and allow others to get their questions in. And on the record, Mr. Roberts and Mr. Zucker, I'm going to start with you, because when we talk about mergers or deals or unions, things of that nature, whether it's large or small, we talk about how it's going to affect the consumer. And I mentioned this in my opening statement, and what I would like to hear from you, from each of you, is a statement as to why this is a good deal for my constituents, whether they're a consumer or a member of the content production community. And that articulation would be wonderful, and it would be helpful to me. Mr. Thier, to you, you had in your testimony that it would make no sense for the new firm to block new or competing channels, and that Comcast faces robust competition in the video programming marketplace from satellite and telecom providers, as well as from internet-based video providers. So given the robust competition in the video programming marketplace, do you believe that government should impose network neutrality standards on this union, and what would some of the consequences for consumers and innovation be if that intervention took place? Mr. Zucker, you've been associated with NBC for at least a decade and CEO of NBCU for 2 years. And do you think the prognosis is for freestanding broadcast companies in this dynamic? What's the environment? What do you think is going to be the prognosis there? And I am now out of time, it looks like. If I can get one more. I had a question, and this would be actually for all of you. Looking at what the what impact this deal would have on efforts by broadcast to develop additional revenue streams. As I have talked to broadcasters and broadcast companies, they are talking about looking at other streams. And I would like to hear from you all kind of where you're planning to move with this. What do we anticipate being the next move for you? And
Ms. Blackburn, is that sufficient, do you think?
Yes, sir. That's
all right,
enough.
Thank you.
Thank you all. I yield back.
And we will ask those to whom those questions were propounded to respond in writing. Let me also say that other members of the subcommittee will be submitting questions to the witnesses. We would appreciate your prompt answer to those, and the record will remain open for such period of time as is necessary to receive those answers. The gentlelady from California, Ms. Matsui, is recognized for 5 minutes, hopefully less.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. There are about 200 independently owned local TV stations affiliated with NBC Network throughout the country. One of those happens to be in my district, KCRA, which is the region's local NBC station. Many of my constituents, it's a very highly rated station, rely upon KCRA for local news and programming and information. And I want to ensure that KCRA is not put at a competitive disadvantage to NBC-owned stations. Question for Mr. Fiorelli. In your testimony, you speak about the potential need for a strong set of structural separation requirements for the subsidies of Comcast. Can you briefly elaborate on this point, and what safeguards or conditions, if any, do you envision to ensure independently owned NBC affiliates are not put at a competitive disadvantage?
Thank you for the question. The concern that I articulate is such that we currently negotiate with NBC for renewal of our affiliation agreement. And separate and aside from that, we negotiate with a cable carrier for retransmission consent. The potential exists to reach a standstill in negotiations with the cable carrier over retransmission consent, and then to have that same company withhold an affiliation renewal from the network. So what we would hope is that there'd be some kind of separation between the two, and in particular a remedy that cable carrier could find if we were at a standstill in negotiations over retransmission consent is the network could be brought in around the local affiliates, circumventing the retransmission consent process.
Okay. Mr. Zucker, do you agree with the assertion that structural separation may be necessary?
I don't think it's necessary. I think that we've always been able to, in the course of these conversations with the affiliates, work this out. There's never been any issue with regard to that, and I don't foresee any need for it going forward.
You don't foresee any need at all? Okay. As I mentioned in my statement, there are concerns that this joint venture may cause a domino effect in industry, and some critics of the proposed joint venture fear that this deal will create competitive pressures that will result in further joint ventures between content and distribution companies. Mr. Cooper, in your opinion, this joint venture goes through, how would the media and entertainment landscape change over the long run? I think you have to quickly address that.
Well, as I said in my testimony, the great fear is that you create a merger wave where all of the other entities look at the advantage that Comcast has gained, one of which is described by Mr. Fiorelli, and say, I have to get as much of a similar advantage as I possibly can, particularly because there's this market division between cable operators. So the cable operator elsewhere will say, I've got to have the same deal. And you will create a situation in which everyone is seeking to gain maximum leverage through that sort of integration.
Okay. I have other questions, and I'll just yield back my time right now.
Thank you very much. Ms. Matsui, I would suggest you submit them in writing. Ms. Castor, you are recognized for 7 minutes. Hopefully less.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mine's kind of a follow-on to Congresswoman Matsui's question. Under the FCC public interest test, you'll be asked to determine, is this transaction in the public interest and is it convenient does it promote convenience and necessity? What about customers who don't have Comcast or not served in that area? For example, in the Tampa Bay area, which is the largest media market in the state of Florida, it has the flagship NBC affiliate is probably the most successful, highest rated in the entire area. What does this mean for those customers? We're not served. The Comcast cable is a very minor share of the market. Verizon has a much larger share, but what's the impact? How does this promote the public interest for those, for the customers there that are will not have access to Comcast in the near future and maybe won't be able to achieve a larger market share in the future?
May I take that question? I think that I believe it's WFLA in Tampa, which is an affiliate that we're incredibly proud to be associated with. I think what's terrific about this proposed joint venture is that Comcast is committing to free over-the-air television and the future of broadcasting. And I have to say that before this joint venture was proposed, I was concerned about the future of broadcasting. It's been under a tremendous amount of duress, especially with the economic woes that we've all suffered. I think Comcast's willingness to commit to the future of over-the-air broadcasting, to step up and say that they're willing and hope that they'll be able to play a constructive role in retrans conversations, all of these give me greater comfort in thinking about the future of broadcasting, and I think that's good for the viewers of WFLA and your constituents in Tampa.
Mr. Field, you heard his answer, and you also heard his answer on the separation condition. What's your reaction to that?
I guess I would look for a more on the previous question. I would look for a stronger condition and for more separation and some clarity on a non-integration of both the network affiliation negotiations and retransmission consent negotiations. The capacity for Comcast to bring benefits to the over-the-air NBC affiliate family, I think there is a real possibility of that.
May I offer an alternative view? In point of fact, Comcast will be in a stronger position to demand bigger bundles at higher prices from your local cable operator, who's not Comcast. They will be in a stronger position to demand higher retrans where they are an O&O. And so those two things will have a negative effect on consumers because they have a stronger bargaining position as a larger integrated entity.
Agreed.
I would just add that, you know, the program access rules that we've been talking about actually haven't applied to NBCU because we haven't been owned by a distributor. In fact, going forward, they will apply, and actually we will now be subject to those rules. So I actually think there's a greater benefit as a result of that and less protection for us.
And hence why the rules need to be reviewed.
Ms. Castor, thank you very much. The gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Rush, is recognized. Questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I do know that we are operating with some severe time restraints. So I'm going to ask Mr. Roberts and Mr. Zucker if you could listen to the question. Maybe you could answer that, each one of you. Have your respective companies done all that they reasonably can to foster minority ownership of communications properties, improve business relationships with existing minority business owners, and recruiting and retention of minority employees? And to the extent that you can, will you divulge to us what and when was the last large transaction that you personally or your executive team struck with a minority-owned firm, and what were their value in terms of dollars and duration?
Well,
I think it's one of my goals personally is to see our company continually improve in diversity. Diversity, how we purchase our goods and services, how our employees are made up and reflect the customers we serve. And I would say I would never give us a perfect scorecard, and I think it's something that we're constantly striving to improve on. And it's a major priority for the company. In terms of media-owned assets, the last deal that I can think of was the New York Times Company a decade ago sold their cable systems. To a minority-owned group that we participated in with Bruce Llewellyn called Garden State Cable. And eventually, Mr. Llewellyn and, his, and the group that we partnered with sold their shares after more than half a decade. When we built the cable system in Philadelphia. We also wanted to have local ownership by minority and women businesses. And so we had a separate public company that our Comcast Philadelphia was owned with, and shares were more available to Philadelphia residents who were women and minorities. Eventually, that got bought up. Everyone made a lot of money, 10 times their money or more. So as we have, from time to time, had to dispose of certain assets, we've always looked for ways to find creative opportunities with minority entrepreneurs. We do the same for purchasing of vehicles and other hard goods. We spend about $5 billion a year on capital spending, so there's a great opportunity to support businesses with smaller ownership than just the large owners.
Mr. Rush, can we move on? Thank you very much. The gentleman from Vermont, Mr. Welch, is recognized for hopefully one or two questions.
Thank you very much. Mr. Roberts, my understanding is you want to be treated the same on net neutrality. And if there were any conditions that were imposed as part of this arrangement, you'd want them imposed on everyone else. Is that more or less right?
I think, I'm not sure there should be, that there's been proof that the Internet isn't growing fast enough or that there should be rules. But if there are new rules that want to be put forth, I think it should not be a competitive differentiator that they apply to some and not to all.
Well, if in the course of this there were rules that applied to net neutrality, would you be supportive of them as long as they were applied across the board to everyone else?
I think it depends on the rule. But okay. Conceptually, we're participating right now with the FCC. We've put in comments, and we think there is a constructive dialogue led by Chairman Jenikowski.
Right. We're going to have to go quick because we're going to vote. But I want to ask you about the availability of non-affiliated content on TV everywhere. Are you going to be asking you, Comcast, asking independent programmers to sign exclusivity deals with you or with your TV everywhere partners?
Absolutely not.
You won't be doing that. That's good. Again, I go back to this concern about the bundling of services and whether there are mechanisms to work out payment disputes. Right now, I understand arbitration is theoretically available. If, for instance, you and a smaller programmer like the WOW Network had a dispute about pay, arbitration is theoretically available. Is that right?
There's a dispute resolution mechanism at the FCC, yes.
Okay. Ms. Abdullah, does that work as a practical matter? What's involved if you have a dispute with a larger distributor? And we don't have to single out Comcast here, but how does arbitration work as a practical remedy to resolve the dispute?
You would file a complaint, and then there's the depositions and all the data gathering. And you asked, is it effective? No. It is a long process. The worst part about it is two things. You do not get guarantee that the programmer will keep that service on while you're in dispute. That's huge, because customers then lose the signal, and now it's a problem for your consumers, your paying consumers who lose the right signal. That's a big issue. And secondarily, I would have to be the one that would prove that the pricing's not right, and I don't have exposure to market pricing or data. That's huge.
Let me ask Dr. Cooper, is there a suggestion you would have to provide fairness, and I mean to the two, whether it's in this case Comcast and WOW, that would resolve this dispute in a reasonable way so that they both of their interests were respected?
Right.
Frankly, if you listen to the list of promises that people have tried to extract, of conditions that people have talked about, there's 15 or 16. They can't be enforced effectively to preserve competition in the marketplace. The last decade has proven that the FCC is incapable of enforcing these conditions. So on this merger, the answer is it should not go forward, and Congress needs to revisit all of these other problems as a general proposition.
Okay, Mr. Thier, how
Mr.
about
Mr. Welsh,
you?
If it's okay with you, so that other members can ask one question.
Yep, I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You.
Ms. Christensen from the Virgin Islands is recognized for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And since some of my questions on whether the regulations were strong enough, I think, have been at least alluded to, and the diversity issue has been partially addressed, let me just ask one question. The unions, especially the CWA, has concerns based on what they say have been a difficult history, and this is to Mr. Roberts, and Mr. Roberts particularly, but Mr. Zucker might answer, with their history with Comcast, but also on the possibility of what might happen to jobs at a time when this country is focused on expanding jobs. So what do you plan or foresee the impact of this proposed merger would be on jobs?
Thank you for that question, because it's something I'm very proud of. Comcast today has over 100,000 employees, and when we started the company, Ralph, what was it, 12 in Tupelo? 12 in 1963. I think we have a one-way track record of creating jobs in this country, and now with NBC Universal having another 33,000 employees, the thing that I'm most excited about this deal is the hardest thing to convince investors, which is that there's not going to be massive job cuts as part of this coming together. We don't own a news channel, a broadcast network, a movie studio, so there isn't the overlap that typically you see in horizontal deals where then the first benefit is firing people. The great ideas of this country, Google, what Apple's doing, are adding, not by subtracting. And so this deal is a risk. We've been talking about the uncertainty of the future and what's happening in technology. It's not clear that it's a sure thing, what's happening to broadcast, what's happening in the internet. And there's an investment and a passion that has to come with how you operate a company of this nature. And I think it starts with having a great relationship with your employees. And if they're in a union, respecting that. And if they're not, it's their right to choose one, and hopefully, either way, we create a fabulous work environment that ultimately we create great products that consumers will want.
Thank you very much, Ms. Christensen. The gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Doyle, is recognized.
Thank you, and I'll be brief, Mr. Chairman. Even though Comcast is from that other city in Pennsylvania, they have been solid citizens in Pittsburgh since their entry into the market in 2002. And I'd like to enter into the record a letter from our Mayor Luke Ravenstahl and Councilman Doug Shields in support of the Comcast merger.
Without objection.
Just a quick question. I also want to say that in Pittsburgh, Comcast workers are unionized, and we appreciate that. And Comcast has worked with the unions in Pittsburgh, and they have a good relationship, and I want to state that for the record. Very quickly, Mr. Roberts, there's been many news articles about how some in the copyright businesses have been pressuring ISPs to disconnect their users if they've been alleged to illegally downloaded copyrighted materials. It's been called the Three Strikes Program or the Graduated Response. Now, I checked with your staff, and I'm told that Comcast does not currently disconnect users, and I want to say that I appreciate that policy, because our concern is there's no avenues for the users to have a due process, and we've seen many instances where people have been accused of doing something illegal. Turns out they hadn't, and I just want to make sure that Congress hopefully will not be passing an explicit mandate for three strikes. So absent one, will Comcast continue to commit not to cut off their customers from the internet without some sort of due process procedure?
Well, first of all, thank you for the introduction. What I said earlier, and if I might, and we maybe can submit some comments as the chairman has allowed for specifically that rule and that test. We think that by having made a multi-billions of dollars of investment here in content and still being 80% a distributor, we can play a constructive role in figuring out what is the right technological answer that protects the consumer and protects the copyright so that what is going over is legal and is protected and keeps these businesses viable. We've seen in other industries where that has gotten so bad that the viability of the industry has been jeopardized. Exactly what the right answer is, I'm not prepared today to say that I know. Obviously, many smart minds are there, but I'm going to spend a lot of time and energy at this, more than I have in the past, because of the fact that we have such a large stake now in content if this deal happens. How best to do that, I don't know right now. I don't know, Jeff, if you have a point of view on that. But some have said we should go to that three strike, and we're trying to figure that out as we speak. And we certainly are going to try to use both industries to talk to each other through the trade associations in a more cooperative way than has ever happened before.
I just hope it's not based strictly on the people making accusations without some sort of due process
on the
other end.
I understand.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Doyle, and thanks to all of the members for their expeditious questions here, at least during the last half hour. And thanks to all of our panel members for informing us as thoroughly as you have on this matter of public interest. We will be submitting
to you
some additional questions in writing, and the record will remain open for such period of time as is needed to receive your responses. The gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Dingell.
Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you for that. I was getting ready to ask that question. Mr. Chairman, I would also urge that the committee call the FCC and the Department of Justice before us. There's a number of questions that appear here to be in need of answer. I recognize there's matters that are before those two agencies, but I think we could craft a proper hearing to get their proper input without intruding into the Pillsbury role.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dingell, for that constructive suggestion. And we are going to adjourn this hearing. We now have to respond to the recorded votes on the floor, and the clock stands at zero. So we'll be sprinting over there. Thanks so much to the witnesses today for your attendance and your answers to our questions.
A House hearing here on the proposed merger of Comcast and NBC wrapping up a little later this afternoon. There'll be a Senate hearing with the same officials testifying, and you can follow that live on C-SPAN.org. We're going to go live now to the National Press Club. You see Commerce Secretary Gary